Hello, Harvest family. My name is Sarah Ports, and I serve as the Senior Director of Harvest Kids at the church. I am so glad that you have joined us today. Whether you call to Harvest your church home or you're a guest with us today, I invite you to check in. You can do that at the top of this page if you're on our website, or you can do it on the Harvest app. It lets us know that you are here and how we can care for you. You know, a lot of things have changed in the past several months, but one thing that remains the same is we have staff available to pray with you at any time. If you would like someone to pray with you, just click live prayer if you're on our website. And if you're on Facebook or YouTube, just click the link in the comments and one of our staff will reach out to pray for you. I want to thank you, Harvest family, for your continued faithful giving. As a quick reminder, you can give online, through the app, through a text, or by mail to our Rolling Meadows campus. Now, wherever you are, will you stand up and join me as we worship the one true God?
Oceans of kindness, wave after wave, mercy arriving again and again. Your love will find us, you're never far away. Battles behind us, battles ahead. God, you are for us, so what stands against? We have this promise, you're never far away. In the darkest night, we've seen your goodness, God. Favor on our eyes, everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Your grace is on our side. Ahead, God, you are for us. So what stands against? Oh, we have this promise that you're never far away. No, we've seen your faithfulness in the darkest night. We've seen your goodness, God, favor on our lives. Everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Is on our side, whatever comes our way, God be lifted high. Your love will never fail. We will testify that everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Whoa, your grace is on our side. Hey. From glory to glory in Jesus' name, from morning to day. God, favor on our lives, everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Whoa, your grace is on our side. Whatever comes our way, God be lifted high. Your love will never fail. We will testify that everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Whoa, your grace is on our side.
standing on the edge of everything I know. Comfort is behind me, but I've got to let that go. It's freedom in the free fall. I'm falling into you. God knows where I'm going, so maybe I don't have to. I lay me down at the altar. Comfort is in knowing that you're right here next to me. So I lay me down at the altar. Over and over, over and over. From fear to faith I surrender. Trust your name. I gain it all in the letting go. So I'm letting go. You are in control. I find my life when I give it up. So I give it up. I can trust. Sing it again. I gain it all in the letting go. So I'm letting go. You are
control. I find my life when I give.
this, God, I believe the truth that you hold it all, so I can give it all to you. I lay me down at the altar, over and over, over and over. Every day, from fear to faith, I surrender, over and over, over and over.
In the darkness we were weighed without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from the throne of endless glory to a cradle.
Oh,
Jesus Christ. God, we say that you're worthy of it all. Worthy of my time and all that I have. 'Cause you deserve the glory. Because of who you are, and because of what you've done. Every perfect gift is from you, so I give it all back to you, 'cause you deserve the glory. It's in the perfect name, and it's in the matchless name.
For us, we serve and we worship a King who's given everything. So what could we do but give it back to you? So you deserve the glory, God. We love you, Lord. It's in the name of your Son Jesus that we pray. Amen. Amen.
As we continue in worship, I want to make you aware of a few important events coming up. Students, there is an amazing finish to our Harvest Students in Place this Wednesday, May 27th. We're calling it our spring finale, and it is a 12-hour live stream event. It's gonna start at 8 a.m. on Wednesday and go to 8 p.m. There's gonna be teaching and worship and games and fun, and you don't wanna miss this. So go to harveststudents.org this Wednesday. Then our following week, we'll start our summer schedule. So check with your small group and your email for more details. We are so grateful for everything that God is doing in and through Harvest Christian Academy. And we want to make you aware of all of that is happening. So check this out.
Here, we raise lions. Not these kinds of lions. These kinds of lions. The kind of lions that
serve hard,
work hard,
study hard,
play hard,
love, even when it's hard.
When mistreated, they show kindness. When growled at, they don't growl back, but find common ground. These lions are special. Because these lions we are raising are
problem solvers,
team builders,
bridge builders,
innovators,
competitors,
peacemakers,
people who will make a difference for good in tomorrow's world.
We believe they can, and we believe they will. They have
more potential,
more possibility,
more influence
than any other generation. These are the kind of lions we are raising. The kind of lions that will bring
water to the thirsty,
dignity to the forgotten,
protection for the innocent,
cure and healing,
hope to the world.
And in all of their championships, titles, awards, and scholarships, one thing wins above all else. These lions choose to love. This is how we are raising them. Not because they know to love yet, but because they were loved first. This is what we mean when we say
we
are lions.
We raise these kinds of lions.
We love our school. And if you are interested in a Christian education for your children or your grandchildren, you can check out harvestchristianacademy.org for more details and for fall enrollment. Men, the June event this year is called Man of the House, and it opened registration this past Friday. We want you to be a part of this on Friday and Saturday, June 12th and 13th, so here are a few details. One, it's free and online, but we want you to register, so go to harvestbiblechapel.org/manofthehouse. And this is for all men, whether you attend Harvest or not. So join us and watch for more details. This Memorial Day weekend, we want to pause and remember those who gave their lives for our freedom. If your family lost someone who died serving our country, we want to say thank you for your sacrifice. I want to invite you right now to write some words of thanks in the chat to the families of those who lost someone who was protecting our freedom. Thank them for their sacrifice. Thank them for the love of our country. Will you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your sovereignty. We thank you for how you protect and lead and guide us. Father, I specifically thank you for all of those who gave their lives serving our country to protect our freedoms. Father, I pray for those families that are grieving the loss of those people. But Lord, I ask that you bring them comfort, knowing that their sacrifice is something that models after your sacrifice. Father, you laid your life down for us, and we could not be more grateful for the reality of what that means. Lord, you have saved us from our sins. You have cleansed us from all unrighteousness. And Father, we just exalt and praise and worship you. Father, I ask that you be with all of us this weekend. Continue to provide protection for us. And Lord, we just we lift up thanks for all that you are doing and all that you will do. Father, we love you, and it's in your precious name we pray. Amen.
I put all my hope on the truth of your promise, and I steady my heart on the ground of your goodness. When I'm bowed down with sorrow, I will lift up your name, and the foxes in the vineyard will not steal my joy, because you are good to me, good to me.
Good to me, good to me, good to me.
to me, good to me. You are good to me. Yeah. And your goodness and mercy shall follow me. Trust in your promise, yeah, your goodness and mercy shall follow me all my life. I trust in your promise.
Well, hey, Harvest, does anybody remember that song that we used to sing here probably around 2010 called Jesus, You Are Worthy? The chorus ended with the line, "For with your blood you purchased us for God. Jesus, you are worthy. That is what you are." My favorite part of that song was the tag that comes at the end of it where it would say, "Justice and mercy. Justice and mercy meet on the cross." Jesus is the person in which we can see both justice and mercy. We see it on the cross for sure, but we also see it in the kingdom he's building as the Messiah. But if you pay attention to how things are here on earth, we've driven some hard lines in the sand, forcing people to choose justice or mercy. It's one of the great divides in earthly kingdoms. Do you seek justice or do you seek mercy? Well, in the kingdom of God, you will find that there is both justice and mercy. Psalm 33, verse 5 says, "He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord." God loves justice, but in his mercy, he shows love to the world. And that's what we're going to see here in this passage today. God's justice and mercy. Here, Mark is going to present God's justice and mercy with 2 points about his justice and 1 point about his mercy. It's kind of like a bad news, good news kind of situation. So open your Bible to Mark chapter 11 as we continue in our series, Just Jesus, Bold Servant. Let me just give you a heads up. We're going to be going through some pretty weighty topics pretty fast today. And the last thing I want to do is just overwhelm you with information. So as I'm teaching today, can you just open your heart to hear what it is that God wants to say to you? I want you to understand what's happening here in this passage, but I've been praying this week that more than information, God would bring transformation. And at the end of the message, I'm going to walk you through a couple ways that you can apply what we're learning, but it all starts with you giving God's word your full attention. And I know it's not easy to do. It's actually really easy to get distracted as we're watching these messages online. But I want to challenge you to stay for this entire message today. I'm not asking you to give me your attention. I'm asking you to give God that attention. But before we jump in, let me pray for us. Father, we come to you today with open hearts, asking that you would be the one to speak. We thank you for your word. We thank you for how it instructs us. We thank you for how we are the ones who get to see it come to life and how the information will jump out at us and cause transformation in our hearts. God, that's what we want today. We want whatever you want. Have your way here today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, last week we talked about Jesus's entrance into Jerusalem, and we ended with verse 11 of Mark chapter 11, where Jesus goes into the temple and sees what's going on there. But because it was late, he goes to Bethany. That's the city that's 2 miles outside of Jerusalem to spend the night. And verse 11 is our indicator that the intensity of his entry is continuing into the next day. You remember last week we talked about how the way Jesus entered Jerusalem claimed messianic authority. And the only reason he didn't flip those tables in the temple on Palm Sunday was because it got late. So keep that intensity in mind as we enter into Monday of Passion Week. Over the next few weeks, as we study these passages, Jesus is crossing a milestone that will lead to his crucifixion. He's going to curse a fig tree as a symbol of judgment. He's going to cleanse the temple, which is going to cause a firestorm against him. Then his authority is going to be challenged, and he's going to give a parable against the religious leaders. Whew, what a day for Jesus. And here we are at the beginning of that day in verse 12. But before we jump in, let me just give you a teaching point on how to study the Gospels. We've not only been learning what Mark has for us, but we've also been learning how to look at the parallel accounts of Matthew, Luke, and John as well. God revealed to us what happened in the life of Jesus through four different writers with four different personalities. There's no contradiction or error between them, but they are distinct books, and they come with style differences. And if you're not conscious of that, things can get a little confusing. So here's a helpful tool for you as you study the Gospels, and it's also going to come in handy for us today. When you find differences between how the Gospels are giving an account of an event in the life of Jesus, I want you to ask yourself this question. Am I being given a box or a list? A box or a list? See, a box is filled with items that go together. So check this box out. If we were going to make pancakes, we would have this box, and in it you would find some eggs, you would find some milk, some flour, and some syrup. And they go together because it's how we're going to make our pancakes. But it's just putting them in such a way that we can see them all at once. But that's not like a list. A list is going to give us a sequential order. So in this analogy, it would be more like the shopping list, or better yet, the recipe of how to make pancakes, because the recipe is going to tell us that we don't just put all those things together in one bowl. The recipe is going to tell us the order in which to put them in the bowl and then to cook the pancake, and that the syrup is the part that goes at the end. See, they're different things. It's a box or a list. And we use those two things in the way we speak today as well. Let me illustrate it this way. If you were to ask me, hey, Eddie, what did you learn during your graduate studies when you were getting your master's? Well, I would answer and say, I learned about orchestration. I learned about music production. I learned about the history of film. And when I say those things to you, you wouldn't be upset to find out that I actually learned about the history of film before I learned about orchestration. Because the way I told you, I wasn't giving you a chronological list. Now, if I wanted to do that, I would say, well, in my first semester, I learned about the history of film. And then in my second semester, I learned about orchestration. See, it's the triggers in my words, in the way that I give it to you, that let you know if it's a box that I'm giving you or a list. And that trigger in the Gospels is the word chi. Kai is most often translated as the word and it's a chronological marker. And Mark's account of this event is the only one that uses those markers showing us that he's giving us a list. So his account that we're studying today is going to have the chronological details of the day, which is laid out as fig tree part one, then the cleansing of the temple, and then fig tree part two. Meanwhile, Matthew doesn't give us those chronological markers, so he's showing us that he's giving us a box. There's the cleansing of the temple and then the fig tree part one and two together. That's how he gives it to us. And this was extremely common in Greco-Roman culture. Just ask any historian. I'm not making this stuff up. It's very, very common in those times. And as I've illustrated to you today, it's still very common in modern day in the way we speak. I take the time to explain this to you because I want you to understand why Matthew and Mark order the events of the day differently. There's no contradictions, just a different approach. One is a box, the other's a list. So here, Mark is unpacking three movements in this passage about God's judgment and God's blessing, God's justice and his mercy. Movement one, the fig tree, a symbol of God's judgment. Let's jump in here at verse 12. It says, "On the following day, when they came from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, he went to see if he could find anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And he said to it, 'May no one ever eat fruit from you again.' And his disciples heard it." Now, notice that the fig tree is in leaf. Unlike other trees, the fig tree bears fruit at the same time that it's in leaf. Actually, the first fruits show up right before it's in leaf. So this detail means that we would expect to see fruit on this fig tree. But Jesus finds that the tree has no fruit because it was not in season. In season meaning it's not the time to harvest the fig tree. But that doesn't mean there isn't supposed to be any fruit on it. What should be on this tree is the first ripe fruit or the early fruit. In the Old Testament, the prophets used the symbol of the fig tree all the time, and it was a symbol of God's people, and then the fruit was a symbol of their obedience to God. So here in this symbol, we see this expression that God expects obedience and faith from his people as fruit, but doesn't see it. He doesn't see the early fruit of his people. What should be expected of them? Actually, in Micah chapter 7, verse 1, God expresses that he's like the person who sees no fruit after the summer harvest because it's all been eaten. And he tells us that what he hungers for is the first ripe fruit from the fig tree. Isn't that amazing? God's saying, the first thing I expect from my people is their obedience to me, that they would bear spiritual fruit. And this symbol will apply to Jewish leaders, but it will also apply to anyone who rejects him. And what rings true today, thousands of years after this event, is the truth that those who reject Jesus will face God's judgment. And I don't take joy in telling you that, but it's real. All who reject Jesus will be under God's judgment. But here's the good news. If you choose to believe that Jesus was who he said he was, and if you trust in him for salvation, then God will spare you of that judgment. And that judgment is given symbolically to us by Jesus when he curses that tree to never bear fruit again. One day, there will be a point of no return. Hebrews 9:27 says, "And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment." Once you die, there is no longer a chance for you to change your mind. And I can't even guarantee you or I will get to finish today. So if you hear his voice, don't harden your heart, because one day God's judgment will be final. Movement two, the temple, Jesus enacting God's judgment. Verse 15, and they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. This is actually the second time Jesus has done this as far as driving people out of the temple. We know this because John tells us about the first time he does it in John chapter 2. The two main reasons we know that's a separate occasion than this one in Mark 11 are, well, the first reason is because the mention of destroying the temple is only in John's account. And this is what the religious leaders use against Jesus in Matthew 26:61 when they're accusing him in order to condemn him to death. But their recollection of what he said isn't airtight. It's pretty blurry at that point, which would be consistent with how the Gospels present the fact that the destroy the temple comment came 3 years earlier in the book of John rather than 3 days earlier if it was all the same event. Jesus says that line about destroying the temple at the beginning of his ministry, and now they're misremembering it. So that's the first reason. The second reason is that after Jesus does this the first time in John chapter 2, no one goes after him to kill him. Instead, the people in Jerusalem start believing in him. And then it says that he did not entrust himself to them, meaning he didn't reveal much about his mission and purpose at that time. But here in Mark 11, we're seeing that 3 years after the first cleansing of the temple, Jesus does it again. And now the leaders are ready to kill him. So big picture, yes, this is a similar event, but clearly it's not the same event being described by John. All right, moving on. Here, we see people buying and selling stuff in the temple, as well as changing their currencies with their money changers, since people are showing up from all different places, so they're bringing in foreign currency and need to change it to pay the temple tax at Passover and buy animals for sacrifices. But Jesus isn't rebuking them for what they're doing. He's rebuking them for where they are doing this. Historical evidence shows us that these shops were originally set up on the Mount of Olives, which is just outside of Jerusalem. But now they're in the court of the Gentiles, which was inside the temple precincts. The temple was the place where God's presence would dwell. And it was the place where God's people would worship him. And some people have tried to use this passage to say that you can't have any selling of anything in any way in a church building. No coffee, no conference t-shirt, nothing, absolutely nothing. But that's not what's being taught here. First of all, today we are now the temple where God dwells, not our buildings. And that's why we can say that even in this time, the church is not closed. The buildings, sure, but not the church. The irreverence that's happening here is much more like throwing an announcement into the middle of an ascriptive worship song. If you're new to Harvest, maybe you know this or maybe you don't, but we're actually really intentional about how we plan our services because we want to get to the place every single weekend where we're looking up to God and we are singing to God directly and singing to God about God. Where it's all about him. It's all about ascribing worth to him. And sure, there's a place in worship for gathering God's people. And there's a place in worship for giving testimony of what God's done. That's when you tell of the works of God in your life. There's a place for that. But we don't want to end there. We want to get to the place where we're looking to God. And we're singing to God. And telling him all the awesome things that he's done. And all the awesome things that he is. That's what it means to ascribe worth to him. So here at Harvest, we take that very seriously, and it's really a sacred moment every single weekend when we take our eyes off ourselves and we look to God. Because I've found that in those songs that lean more towards testimony, I find comfort in the presence of God. But it's not until I turn my eyes to God that I get the better perspective. And that's when my heart finds healing. That's when I find the strength to keep going. It's in those moments when we're ascribing worth to God. So today in our service, we actually sang the song Worthy of It All. Now imagine if in the middle of singing that, something happened like we're singing, you are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. And don't forget to buy your t-shirt. It's only $20. See, that example was so inappropriate that it probably made some of you cringe. You're cringing because it's absurd. And what's happening here in the temple is just that, something absurd. This is the place where God's presence would dwell. And now it had been turned into looking no different than the market around the corner in the streets of Jerusalem. And Jesus enters Jerusalem in such a way that he is claiming his rightful position as the Messiah. And that idea continues in him having the messianic authority to cleanse the temple. Jesus is inaugurating the kingdom of God by calling the religious authorities to restore true worship to the temple or face God's judgment and destruction. Just like the fig tree was in leaf advertising that it would have fruit but didn't, the Jewish leaders are advertising the spiritual fruit of Israel. But Jesus is showing that they offer no fruit. They offer no obedience to God. And this will lead to God's judgment. Verse 17 says, and he was teaching them and saying to them, is it not written, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations, but you have made it a den of robbers. The phrase house of prayer for all the nation comes from Isaiah chapter 56, and the phrase den of robbers comes from Jeremiah chapter 7. So here Jesus is teaching them that God already said that this temple would be the light of God's glory to the whole world, where not just Israel, but foreigners, that's you and me, we can also be a part of God's family if we're faithful to God. And they turn God's house of prayer into a den of robbers. The word den is referring to a cave that you would run to or find shelter in as a rebel against God. And here the religious leaders are hiding in the temple, thinking that if God made this place holy, then he won't destroy it, and therefore he won't destroy us. This is such a human plan versus God's plan. And before we cast our quick judgment as if we aren't anything like these religious leaders, think about how many times you've used a human plan instead of God's plan. God's plan for you when your sin is revealed is repentance and obedience. And yet how many times do we respond to sin being revealed in our lives by sinning and disobeying even more? So maybe that's you today, and something has kind of hit the fan recently in your life, and you're struggling with what to do next. Please, hear me, please choose God's plan instead of trying to find shelter in your own plan. Turn away from your sin and come into the light. Though it may be painful, I promise you that there is an indescribable joy and treasure on the other side. If you choose God's plan, what Jesus does here is of epic proportion. I can't emphasize that enough. I hope you don't have like a dramatization from a movie in the 90s about how this all went down. What happens here is a shutdown that probably lasted the entire day here in the temple. And it's Passover week, right? And that means that there's hundreds of thousands of people in Jerusalem offering sacrifices, and Jesus steps in and shuts it down. No wonder the response in verse 18, it says, but the chief priests and the scribes heard it and were seeking a way to destroy him, for they feared him, because all the crowd was astonished at his teaching. And when evening came, they went out of the city. What Jesus has done here is so disruptive, no wonder the leaders are seeking to destroy him. That means they want to kill him. They are enraged by what Jesus is doing. And this tension is just getting started. Stick around for the coming weeks. We're going to see more of that. But here the leaders are threatened by Jesus because they see how the crowds are astonished or they're blown away by what Jesus was teaching. So Jesus is enacting God's judgment on the temple. He disrupts this hypocritical religion before God, and ultimately, this temple is going to be destroyed by the Romans 40 years later. And there hasn't been another temple since then. Here, Jesus is bringing justice. But the next day, we get to see his mercy. Movement 3, faith in God, a merciful invitation. Starting in verse 20. As they passed by in the morning, they saw the fig tree withered away to its roots, meaning it's super dead. And Peter remembered and said to him, Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered. It's withered away to its roots, showing the finality of God's judgment. And in Matthew's account, he tells us that after Jesus cursed that fig tree, it withered at once. And that doesn't mean it withered instantly. That means at once it began to wither. Like it started right away. And thanks to Mark's account, we know that when Matthew then says, when the disciples saw it, that refers to them seeing it on the next day, when Peter notices that the tree is super dead now. Again, it's bringing light to the finality of God's judgment. Continuing in verse 22, and Jesus answered them. Here it is. Have faith in God. Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be taken up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Here we find, sadly, one of the most misinterpreted verses in the Bible. Like I mentioned a couple weeks ago, you aren't supposed to only stay in the shallow end of swimming in the scriptures. You have to dive in. Because if you don't, then you end up reading verse 24 thinking you can pray for a private jet and God's guaranteeing that if you believe you will get it, then he will give it to you. And if it doesn't happen, people get told it's because they didn't have faith. And with a private jet, it's not that big a deal. But people get told this about very personal needs, and it is very destructive to the soul. But biblically speaking, faith is the assurance of things hoped for and the convictions of things unseen. And here, it is very important to jot down this sentence. Here, I'll say it twice. I really want you to have this sentence down. Faith always includes both the assurance that God has the ability to do something and the conviction that he alone is the one deciding if something should happen. Let me say that again. Faith always includes both the assurance that God has the ability to do something and the conviction that he alone is the one deciding if something should happen. I mean, just look at Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. As he is asking God the Father for this cup to pass from him, he says, but not my will, your will be done. And then when he teaches us to pray, he says, your kingdom come, your will be done. James 4:3, you ask and don't receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your own passions. But as you pray that God's will would be done, you're still supposed to ask. Don't let that last point dissuade you from bringing your requests to God. His merciful invitation is for you to pray in faith and ask that God would do it. Jeremiah 33:3, God says, call to me and I will answer you. The calling comes before the answering. Then Matthew 7:7, Jesus says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. Ask, seek, knock. It's so clear that this is how we are to pray in faith. So let me make it just super practical today. Here are the three things you need to do to pray in faith. Apply this to anything you've been praying for. First, you need to believe that God has the power to do it. Then, you have to trust that what He decides to do or not to do is best. And then finally, call out to God and ask Him to do what you are praying for. All three of those things. Believe that He has the power to do it. Trust that He's the one who should decide if it should happen. But then bring your request to Him and ask Him to do it. That's how you pray in faith. See, some of you need to unlock your faith in your prayer life by seeking to align your requests with the will of God. Praying and pleading for God to do miracles for His glory, and if it's in accordance to His will. I can't tell you if that miracle is what will bring God greater glory, but I trust God to decide that. And my job is to pray. I'm just going to be real with you guys today. Sometimes I'm praying for the miracle, and as I'm praying for the miracle, my eyes start to open up and see that there's been different miracles around me the whole time I was praying. But if I didn't pray in faith, I would miss out on seeing those miracles. And my faith grows because my trust in God's ability to change anything grows, and by trusting in His will and His purposes. But my job, your job, is to pray, and to pray with faith. Here in the context of these verses, what God is saying to His disciples, and in effect to you and me, is this. See this tree that is a symbol of judgment of those who reject me? Well, as my followers, I want you to know that you're going to face some very difficult things as you follow me. It's not going to be an easy journey. But as you have faith in me, I will throw those mountains into the sea. There will always be a path for you to follow me, and that path will be paved by prayer when you and I spend time together. And as you spend more time with me, your trust in my plans and my strength will increase. And when you pray for those obstacles that are in your way, as you follow me, trust me, I will take care of them. Do you hear His voice today in this passage? Jesus isn't just talking about a mountain. He says this mountain, which in the context of this passage, He's saying the Temple Mount, Mount Zion, the place representing those who have rejected God and are just religious zealots instead of faith-filled followers of Jesus, the Messiah. Jesus and His followers are waging a war of faith against the mountain of unbelief. And then the final verse, verse 25 that we're studying today, says, and whenever you stand praying, forgive if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father also who is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. The reality of us listening to that verse in modern day feels like Jesus changed the topic by talking about forgiveness. Wait, I thought we were talking about having faith in God and waging a war against unbelief. Well, in the Bible, being forgiven by God and forgiving others, they go hand in hand. You can't separate receiving the forgiveness of God and forgiving others. I think the clearest way I can say it to you is with two statements. And the first one's a false statement. Here it is. If I forgive other people, then God will forgive me. That's not true. That's a false statement. The true statement is the fact that I've been forgiven by God is evidenced by my forgiving of others. What Jesus is getting at here is that effective prayer must be offered in faith with a spirit of forgiveness. It's his merciful invitation. Don't let unforgiveness towards others get in the way of your relationship with God. And so the tension between Jesus and the religious leaders in the temple will continue to rise. And next week, we're going to see the response of these religious leaders. But for today, we end with this message, seeing God's justice in his judgment, but also seeing his mercy in his invitation to us to have faith in him. And as I mentioned earlier, I want to give you two ways to apply this message. First, maybe as I was talking about how we can often ignore God's plan and insert our own plans like the religious leaders did. And I don't want you to feel judgment. I want you to find the freedom found in obedience to God. If God has revealed a specific area in your life where you're not honoring him, you need to confess it and you need to repent of it. Own up to it. Agree with God that it is sin. Let's just start there. And do whatever it takes to make it right with those your sin has hurt. Is that you? Or the second application, are you pressing in to pray in faith according to God's will? Is there a request that you were praying for a long time about something and then now you've just given up on it? I know exactly what that's like. And today I want to encourage you to pick up that request, back up, and have faith. Have faith that no matter how impossible that seems, believe that God can do it and pray that his will would be done. And you just see how God meets you there. I'm trusting the Holy Spirit right now to be moving his people to respond to one of those two applications. See, there's something awesome happening right now that you are watching a video of this sermon. And some of you are watching this weeks or even months after I preach this. But God is present with you right now. And he knows what you're going through. He knows where you are. So just say yes to him. Whatever he's convicted you with, whatever he's taught you, just say yes. Father, we are so thankful for your word. We're thankful for what you have taught us today. And Lord, for those things that you have revealed and brought into the light, the ways that we're not honoring you, help us to agree with you and help us to turn away from that. We can't do that with our own strength, God. We need you to give us the strength and the ability to be able to turn away from sin. For we know ourselves well. And that's why we need your help, God. And we bring to you our requests. The things that seem impossible to us, we know are not impossible for you. For you are the one who is able to exceed the things that we could even imagine. So we believe, God, that you're able to answer, that you're able to change anything. But we want you to do it in accordance to your will. We trust you with that decision. We don't know what the future looks like. We don't know what's best. We don't know what will bring you the most glory. So God, we gladly submit to the fact that you're the one deciding if something should or shouldn't happen. But God, we thank you that you still invite us to ask. So for all those needs that are being brought to you today, God, we ask in faith and we ask that you would do those things. And we trust you with everything here moving forward. And it's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
From glory to glory, in Jesus' name. From morn to dance, in Jesus' name. From bound to bless, we go in Jesus' name. From glory to glory, in Jesus' name. From morn to dance, in Jesus' name, from bound.
comes our way. You can't be lifted high. Your love will never fail. We will testify that everywhere we go, your grace is on our side.
To rush away, we would love to care for you. If you would like someone to pray for you, click live prayer if you're on our website, and if you're joining us from YouTube or Facebook, click the link in the comments. And because I got to host today, I want to let you know about special resources we have for families with children. You can go to harvestbiblechapel.org/hkathome, or you can check our Instagram at We Are Harvest Kids. Thanks so much. You are loved.